In my experience, people often don't like their protectors, like the internal critic or the food eating part, right, or whatever.
Yeah. Yeah. So when that's happening, of course, that just means there's another blended part that doesn't like the protector, right? And they don't have to like each other.
Right.
And it's important to catch that that dislike,
uh-huh,
of course, doesn't come from self.
Right.
So it's got to be another part.
Yes. Yeah.
So it's helpful to remind clients of that.
Mm.
And then to invite those parts to soften back so you can see them.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So I think your example was a food eating part and a critic.
Mm-hmm.
Right. You shouldn't eat so much, blah, 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 something like that. Yeah. So, right. So you can let that part know, I appreciate your perspective. You don't want me to eat this much. You know, you can maybe ask it how come, and it'll tell you, you know, you're going to get fat and people won't like you, or blah, blah, blah.
Mm-hmm.
And this one, but I like eating, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, how come you like eating? Oh, it tastes really good and it's comforting and blah, blah, blah. And,
mm-hmm,
you know, that may lead us to an exile that's distressed, and habitual responses for this part to come in and provide comfort with food.
Uh-huh.
It may not. It might just be two parts that have different perspectives in the system, which is fine.
Mm-hmm.
I don't need to be either of these parts because I'm not.
Right.
But I can hear them. Right?
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's important when working with protectors that they know that they are respected and appreciated. They both have a positive intent.
Mm-hmm.
They don't have to agree, mm-hmm, but I can appreciate them and respect, mm-hmm, them. And that helps, you know, in a number of ways, but it helps them to know that self's around and self can get it.
Right.
Well, prior to that, what tends to happen is we'll be stuck in one or the other, and this ongoing internal tension. Right?
Uh-huh.
So that's one thing about protectors. And it's helpful also to remember that these parts may have started really early in life. Because early on,
mm-hmm,
the resources we have are external in terms, yeah, of the people that love, support, and nurture us.
Mm-hmm.
But when those people aren't available, the only resources we've had are internal,
mm-hmm,
and that's where our protectors often start, right?
Uh-huh.
Oh, it's not that bad. That's
right.
A comforting, minimizing manager,
uh-huh,
right? And the reason it says it's not that bad is because there's a part sitting there saying, this is really bad.
Mm-hmm.
And if in that moment it's really bad and you're 6 years old,
yeah,
and you can't leave home and you have no other resources,
mm-hmm,
then somehow it has to not be that bad. And that's where the parts begin to get exiled that hold the distress.
Yeah. Right?
And these young managers start out. And this manager may be around forever, right? Oh, you know, that person doesn't seem to like me, but it's not that bad.
Right.
Right. And you get to know it. It's 6 years old and it's,
mm-hmm,
wanting to run the show.
Right? Mm-hmm.
So that's one of the delights of getting to know the protectors, is getting to know how long and how hard they've been working.
Yeah.
So that's a... you know, the thing about the managers too is they tend to be very reasonable. They have that reasonable voice. And managers can be quite easy to subtly blend with because they're just so reasonable.
They are.
Right? So they are. So to catch that reasonableness, mm-hmm, and notice, oh, that's a manager, okay, and ask it to pull back. So you can get to know it, or so you can get to know other parts it might be trying to be reasonable about.
Mm-hmm.
Because not all of the parts are reasonable. So you tend to get, you know, the proactive managers, and then the reactive firefighters will often be polarized.
Right? Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. So, and that's when you talk about parts not liking parts, that's what's going on usually.
Mm-hmm. Right? And talking of firefighters,
mm-hmm,
often the firefighters will be doing really difficult things, in inverted commas.
Yeah.
Like spending the family's money in gambling, or showing up drunk for work,
mm-hmm,
and some of those other problematic behaviours.
Right. Yeah. And I think what's key there is it's behaviours, right? So the managers are seeing these behaviours as problematic, which they are,
mm-hmm,
right? The firefighter's intent, nonetheless,
yes,
is a positive intent.
Right.
Right? And that's what's really helpful to remember and, mm-hmm, to remind clients of, right? So the part itself is not bad, right? That's one thing. If the manager can allow self's curiosity, we can find out about the exile that's usually triggering the firefighter.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Firefighter's not operating in isolation if it's a firefighter.
Uh-huh.
Now, that said, there are firefighter activities,
mm-hmm,
which can be, you know, drinking, eating. Right?
Mm-hmm.
But we also need to drink, we need to eat, and we may choose to drink.
Right.
So the difference between whether or not it's a firefighter activity or an activity is if there's a sense of, I have to do this,
uh-huh,
I need to do this, I'm driven to do this. And that's where the, you know, what we call the addictive behavior, some,
mm-hmm,
of us call the addictive behaviors come in. It's usually an habitual firefighter response. Right?
Uh-huh.
So yeah, if it's driven, if I had to eat that cheesecake, if I feel like I have to, chances are it's connected to an exile. Right?
Mm-hmm.
So then when we want to get to know the firefighter or the exile, of course, check to see if there's any concerns. Uh-huh. Right? There may be manager concerns. If you get to know that part, something negative is going to happen. What's the concern? Address the concern. Mm-hmm.
Right? And when you're working with the system in that way, do you tell the client what you're up to?
It depends. I'll feel it out. It may help the protector, right, to know that our intent is to help the exile. Mm-hmm. Right? And that protector may not believe it's possible to help the exile. It doesn't have to believe that. It may declare it's a waste of time. It's welcome to its opinion. Right? Uh-huh. You don't want to argue. You don't want to argue with a protector because that's another part. Right?
Right.
You're in a parts war. It's like, no, it's not a waste of time because that's right. another part. Right. Mm-hmm. Don't need to argue because the part's entitled to its opinion.
Right.
An opinion is different from a concern.
Oh, say right? some more about that.
All right, so if I want to get to know my angry firefighter, and my manager says, oh, that's just a waste of time, right? Okay, that's your opinion.
Right.
It's our time to waste.
Yes.
Your opinion's noted. Right. Can you soften back? That's an opinion.
Right.
But if it's, you know, oh, we don't want to do that. Right? Mm-hmm. It's a waste of time. Yeah, okay, it's a waste of time, right? Well, and it's dangerous.
Ah.
That's a concern.
Right.
Okay, how come you believe it's dangerous? What do you think might happen? Mm-hmm. Right? And then we're not just asking it to soften back, we're addressing the concern.
I see. Right?
Does that make sense?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes, that sounds like a very important difference and something that especially new therapists might need to pay attention to.
Yes. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Opinions, thank you. Concern, tell me more.
Yes. Okay?
You can invite the protector, once it's heard, to maybe go to a waiting room. Mm-hmm. It doesn't have to be here, basically. You can go to a waiting room, you can go to a garden or a beach, whatever it like. Sometimes I go watch TV if it wants, right? Sometimes they want to stay, and that's fine. Invite them to stay and observe. Do they want to observe from, you know, maybe a room with a window in it? Do they want to monitor what's going on? They're welcome to stay if they want to. They don't have to. Okay. If it's something like an embarrassed part that shows up, oh, that exile is going to let you know about what we did when we were at 10, right? You can let the embarrassed part know. It doesn't have to be here. Self's here, this part's here, and the embarrassed part can also go elsewhere if it would prefer. It doesn't want to stick around. It doesn't have to. Sometimes a part will present, I love when this happens, sometimes a part will present in a really scary way. Right? So the client might say, oh my God, it's this huge monster, right? And you know, it's really scary. So again, ask the parts that are scared, let them know they don't have to be around. And get curious about the, how come it's presenting in such a scary way? Why does it need to, what does it need the client to know? What does it need self to know about its presentation? And often what will happen is these big scary parts are like pufferfish. Look how scary I am. And they're like, 5 years old.
Yeah.
Right? It's a 5-year-old, but I'm scary. Right? Yeah, you're a scary 5-year-old, which just helps the system to relax because there's no fear anymore. So it's what the young part's doing. And it's felt the need to puff itself up. So again, let's get curious about that, right? And usually those really scary parts will morph into a different presentation. And then, you know, do you have a concern, right? So we're going to stick with the curiosity with it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I love the way that happens, the way they morph. As each part steps back,
yes,
they morph a bit more.
Yeah.
And then there's another part steps back and they morph a bit more.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I had one once who showed up as a cartoon presentation. And as I got closer and closer and had more and more parts step back, the cartoon literally split in half and there was a little kid behind
it. Right, yeah. Yeah, that's one of the things I love about this work is the variety of presentations, right?
Yeah.
You actually never know what you're going to find when you go in there, right?
Right. So, fascinating.
Now, another point I want to talk about in terms of protectors is firefighters and their reactivity.
Okay.
Because firefighters are often reacting to the threat that the exile experiences.
Uh-huh. Right?
But because that dynamic is historic in the system, it's from a frozen in time exile, the perception of threat often has nothing to do with what's happening in the present moment.
Yes.
Right? And because the firefighter's job is to protect or distract from or comfort the exile, it will do that in whatever way it needs to do. And if the threat, if the perceived threat happens to come from a beloved partner in that moment, the firefighter is not seeing the beloved partner. The firefighter is seeing threat.
Right?
And it will respond to try and shut down what's stimulating the threat, what's triggering the threat. Which is what causes so much disharmony in relationships sometimes, right? Because that's just the nature of the reactivity.
Yeah.
And then the person who may have inadvertently triggered is saying, why are you being so mean to me?
Right.
Right?
Yeah.
So that can be a sort, once there's an understanding of that's a firefighter's reactivity that's nothing to do with the present moment.
Yeah.
And that Similarly, a firefighter can react to your own child,
right?
Which is an awful feeling, right?
Yes.
But if your kid, you know, triggers you in some way, you know, and a part's feeling like, let's say, you know, you ask your kid to do something three times and your kid doesn't do it, it might trigger a part that feels like it's unheard, right? Young part that never got to be heard and feels disrespected, right? If that's got a lot of energy, the firefighter may well come up.
Mm-hmm.
And again, the firefighter doesn't love your kid. The firefighter's job is not to love your kid. And the firefighter might do something like shout at your kid, right? I told you to do this three times, right? I don't know if you can remember what it's like to have an angry, big, grown-up head leaning over you when you're looking up in this distorted anger.
Mm.
It's really scary for the kid.
Yeah.
So part of the repair in that moment, whether it's your kid or whether it's your partner, is when you get the clarity on what's going on, is to take the responsibility. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. That had nothing to do with you.
Yeah.
I shouldn't have done that. I overreacted or whatever. You're not betraying the firefighter, but you're taking the responsibility for the disruption in the dynamic. That way the kid doesn't take on, there's something wrong with me.
Right.
And take on its own exiles, right? So really important to take the responsibility for the firefighter's behavior, which, again, is not, firefighter's intent is positive, right? And to let it know that you get that.
And they're often so young, those firefighters. They have no idea that they're big, scary men.
Right. That's right.
They think they're six-year-olds.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, and so they may use rage or, you know, belittling meanness, right? And then when the intensity is dissipated and the threat's no longer present, they'll often feel badly.
Uh-huh.
And then the managers will often come in and
guilt
them, right? So helpful to know that that's the dynamic, right? Because self can realize that's what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
The intense positive, let's work with the exile. Once the exile's unburdened, it's not getting triggered. The firefighter doesn't need to come up.
Right.
And it all shifts into more harmony, right? So these are really only indicators of, you know, protector activity is an indicator of an exile that needs some help.
And the stronger the protector, the stronger the exile.
More powerful what the exile's holding, yeah.
Yeah.
So what I love to do with firefighters is let them know, I get that it needed to do that, even though the manager doesn't like it. How long has it been around? Does it go back to childhood? When did it first manifest? These are great questions. And for the firefighter, if it was possible to help that part in a different way from the way it's helping, would it be interested in that? Would it be interested in allowing that?
Great question.
Right? Yeah, you know, and often if they believe it's possible, even if they don't and they're willing to allow, they can pull back a bit to allow access to the exile, right?
Yeah.
So as long as it can show that kind of interest. Right?
Mm-hmm.
And then to switch from the firefighters, you know, the managers tend to hold that vigilance, you know, you know, is there some threat here? So they're the proactive, like trying to assure that there's no threat. They'll often use, as I've talked about before, the minimizing strategies, right? Managers often set high goals for us, the perfectionist part, really common. And you can ask it, how come?
Yeah.
How come it has to be perfect? And oftentimes that's connected to an exile that's not good enough.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll just make it perfect, right? I talked about how managers may shift from blocking to allowing, like more of a valve to allow information to come through. Really common part, the figuring it out part.
Oh, yeah.
Wants to take over, right? So, the reason that happened is because of all this, right? So, figuring out parts, they're brilliant. I've got one that my figuring out part showed me when I was six.
Mm-hmm.
And he figured out, first in class, how to tie his shoes.
Mm.
He's really proud of himself. And he's figured out tons of stuff. But the other parts don't want to be figured out.
Right.
They want to be heard.
Yeah.
So I need to get that one to pull back. And it'll often come in and it'll have like its hypotheses.
Mm-hmm.
This is why that happened, right? Maybe. Let's find out. And then we ask the part.
Right.
And I recently, I had to laugh. I was at the gym working out and there's a display on the elliptical and I wasn't working out as fast or as hard or as good a heart rate as I normally do.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, what's up? How come this isn't so good today? Well, I had a fairly big breakfast. Maybe that's why. And I was up late last night. Maybe if I'm tired, it doesn't work so well. Maybe I'm tired. Why would I be tired? Well, I had a busy day yesterday. No, that's my figuring it out part.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So I caught it, asked it to pull back. And then I asked the part of me that was not producing as well, how come? And all it said was, I don't want to be here.
Ah.
I just don't want to be here doing this elliptical stuff. So it was kind of voting with its feet, slowing the whole system down. Oh,
interesting.
Yeah. Figuring out part could have gone on for hours, you know, theorizing about why I wasn't getting such a good workout. But all I had to do was ask.
This is a great point right here, because I think that one of the dynamics, I mean, I recognize this dynamic, my figuring it out part, I have to work so hard at not having it with me in the therapy sessions.
Right.
Uh-huh. And, you know, in some ways, you know, most of the people who are learning this kind of therapy have also learned other kinds of therapy. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And in those places, the figuring it out parts are okay mm-hmm. In the therapy room. So I think this is a dynamic that we really have to pay attention to as therapists.
Yes. Now, one thing I do with my part, because mm-hmm. it's so good, mm-hmm. is I say to it, you know what? If you come back at the end of the session,
uh-huh.
you will have more material to work with,
uh-huh.
and you'll be able to join even more dots, mm-hmm. because we will get information that we don't currently have.
Brilliant.
And it loves that.
I bet.
It loves to come back at the end of the session and go, oh, that's why I've never done that with this person, you know? So, and it's great at joining those dots, which is actually really helpful.
Yeah, in writing your notes or whatever.
It explains a lot of the behaviors that have been informed by these unconscious exiles and their protectors, right? So, yeah, good to work with the figuring it out part. And most common concern I have come across when we're getting to know exiles, especially the deep exiles, mm-hmm. we're going to be overwhelmed.
Yeah.
Right? And what that means is the system's going to be flooded with, let's say, shame,
uh-huh.
vulnerability,
yeah.
and that's too scary.
Mm-hmm.
Or fear, right? But it's too scary to be that vulnerable.
Yeah.
And the reason those parts usually have those concerns is because it's happened.
Yeah.
At some point, the system's been flooded with a vulnerability that was terrifying, or
yes.
at least really scary. So I completely validate and honor this has happened, mm-hmm. right? And then bring the parts the reassurance, right, that they can either titrate the information from the part.
Mm-hmm.
You can say to the part, I really want to get to know you, and you don't need to flood me for me to get to know you.
Right.
Right. I will promise I will stay with you and I will get what you need me to get. And when the parts hear that, they can self-regulate.
Yeah.
And one of the most important messages that I invite people to be aware of is nothing
mm-hmm.
can overwhelm compassion.
Oh, nice.
It is not possible to overwhelm compassion.
Oh, I like that.
Yeah. And in some people's systems, that has a resonance that just feels like a truth.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Other people's systems, like with any other intervention, well, there's a part saying it doesn't believe that. That's
right.
Fine. We'll work with that part. Don't try to convince a part of anything. But if that truth lands in the system in such a way that the majority of parts can hear it,
mm-hmm.
it can open the way to allow self's compassion to be present for the healing.
Nice.
That needs to happen. Yeah, it is nice. Yeah. Mm. So nothing can overwhelm compassion.
Mm, I like that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Too.
So we've talked about protectors.
Right.
I have a feeling that I know where we're going next.
That'd be the exiles.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
So I'm going to leave this session with a clip.
Mm-hmm.
And this clip is actually an exile speaking, right? Through the voice and body of a little girl about the beliefs she's taken on about herself. So I'm going to leave you with that. Next time, we'll come to the exiles.
Excellent.
All right.
Thank you, Derek.
Thank you.
I'm a stupid little bitch. I should shut up moaning when I'm left on my own at night. I'm fat and ugly and useless. I cry like a baby when I'm slapped. I'm horrible to have around. I don't deserve to have any friends. I never do anything right. I'm not just a stupid little bitch. I'm a nobody.